Very good day to you all. I am Dr. Larry T. Crudup, the pastor of Mount Moriah Baptist Church of Spartanburg, South Carolina. And I want to welcome you to our Community Conversations series. This series endeavors to provide conversations that inform, inspire, and empower you for success. During this series, we will cover an array of topics. This month, we will converse with my wonderful wife, Jacinta Crudup, as she talks with us about effective communication. I don't know about you, but I know that my communication with my family, friends, coworkers, and yes, even the people that get under my skin can be improved. So stop, watch, and listen as we discuss how to more effectively communicate. We hope that these conversations will help you in some way. Don't forget to like this video, share this video, and comment in the comment section below. Also, follow us here on Facebook and on our YouTube page for more soul-feeding content. Enjoy.
Hi, my name is Jacinta Crudup, and I have just moved to Spartanburg in December. So I'm new to the community, but I feel very welcome here. Thank you very much. I've been a teacher for about 10 years, and in that time, I have had the privilege of making these great connections with students and great connections with families, colleagues and the like, and I'm just really looking forward to serving the community with what I've learned over the years.
Okay, we look forward to you serving the community.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for your introduction. And at this time, we will proceed with community conversations. Okay. I would like to ask you to talk about the power of communication. It's worth fighting for. Now, part of this has to do with adults and children, parenting with social, emotional learning in mind. What does that have to do with adults and children communicating with each other?
So social, emotional learning, or SEL, it's very, very important because when it comes to children, they really need that social piece, they need that emotional piece, before they're able to do pretty much anything. It's kind of like, the hierarchy of needs, where there are certain things that you need. You need food, you need water, you need these basic necessities before you are able to do other things and give your attention to other things. It's the same thing when it comes to emotional and social love and serving our children in that way. So when you hear the term SEL, you hear it a lot in the classrooms and schools and stuff. And so I just wanted to make sure, that parents are aware of what it means and how it plays a role in their child's learning and to take it further in their communication. And so as I speak to you about this, then you'll hear me say SEL from time to time.
Okay, so that we know that SEL stands for social emotional learning.
Yes.
Okay. Why should adults fight for communication with their children?
So once children are born, they hit the ground running when it comes to on-the-job training, so to speak. So for the first 3 years, they're listening to us talk, they're watching what we're doing, and with all these things that they are coming across, they are starting to formulate what world is. They're formulating what society means, what relationships means, what relationships mean, what people are, who people are. And so once they get to an age where they're able to start showing those signs, 4 or 5 year olds, and they start to become their own personality, because they have the personality, but it's up to us to pour into them so they can figure out how to utilize that personality, they start to act out what it is that they've seen all over these years. And so whenever we are communicating with our kids, we want to make sure that we are putting inside them something that we will be proud of for us to watch unfold. So for example, when they come into the classroom, if they've heard us just talk down to somebody in our household over and over mm-hmm. and over, or maybe talk down to them over and over and over, it's like a repeated disc that, you know, even if they're not showing it at some point, because that is what they constantly hear, that's what they constantly see, they're going to end up repeating it, or they're going to allow it to happen to them and be accepting of it. And so whenever it comes to things like that, we definitely want to fight for making sure that our communication has substance, whether it's verbal or nonverbal. We want to make sure it has substance. It's pleasing to not only us, but it's pleasing to God, because we definitely have a habit of teaching kids what is pleasing to us because we get annoyed with them. And so we want to make sure that, you know, don't talk to me whenever I'm trying to watch my shows or something like that. And so we've corrected the problem at that time. However, once they, you know, go out and do it, or whenever they get older and they have a younger brother, younger sister, and they're a teenager, don't talk to me while I'm trying to do this. And once you see it, you're like, ooh, they didn't get that from me, did they? Right? And so we have to deal with that. So the whole point is we're fighting for the communication piece, because once our children become adults, we want to make sure that when they get out into that world, they're able to self-advocate, they're able to regulate for themselves, and they're able to have conflict resolution skills, and do this with anybody, even when it comes to us, especially adults, because we don't want to see our kids come to us like that. But it's very important to open up to that.
So that's helping with their development process.
Definitely.
Okay. Definitely. So when would be the best time for us as adults to start healthy communication with the children?
So as soon as you can. Once you're born, it's never too early to start communicating with our children. A lot of nonverbal for little ones, the smiles, the touch, the hugs, things like that. Whenever they are watching us communicate with other people that are loved ones, people that they will in some way communicate with, whether it's a father or other siblings, they're going to be watching that. So being able to talk calmly to our spouses, or being able to, you know, instead of blowing up on the kids, yes, have the firmness, but still have it under control and calmness. So as soon as they're around, we should be practicing what it is that we want from our children. And even whenever they're not there, because, you know, what comes in comes out. So whatever you practice, I tell my students, whatever you practice is hard to undo. A lot of that action becomes a part of you. And so if you're constantly practicing, you know, this stuff, and you're like, okay, well, I only have the kids on the weekend, so I'm gonna do whatever I want to do. And then whenever the kids get into your presence, and you're like, okay, I got to straighten up, I got to do, you know, I got to model this great communication. And then you know, say every single letter, the word in the book that you know, that you probably don't want your kids hearing. You're like, oh, okay, I forgot that the kids were watching. So just as soon as you can.
Okay.
As soon as you can.
And today I saw you and your husband practicing nonverbal communication with the children. Your husband hugged the kids and kissed them, and then he kissed you in front of them. And I thought that was very sweet and romantic, showing the love with the children present. What kinds of things should adults be talking about with their children?
Okay. So again, coming back to those pieces of being able to advocate for yourself whenever kids are by themselves, we want to make sure that they know that they have a voice, and the best place and what should be the safest place for them to practice that is at home. I have a 6-year-old and a 2-year-old, and my 6-year-old, she is getting in the point where she's wanting to speak up for herself more, express herself more, and sometimes that can be pretty frustrating, pretty, you know, annoying and agitating if I'm not, you know, if I'm in a state of like, oh, I can't take, you know. It's a lot going on right now, but I have to remember that if she was with anybody else, is this what I would want her to do? Would I want her to speak up? You know, so being able to help her, help your kids practice self-advocacy, you want to give them the opportunity to practice, model and practice, model and practice. So if they say something inappropriate and you didn't like it, or they said something in a way that you didn't like, you could say, let's try this instead, or we don't say this, let's try this, and you practice it, and now let me hear you say it. That works, you know, more so for the younger. For the older, is just having a conversation with them, just saying, hey, I didn't really like the way that you said that. I understand that you're going through some things. We can talk about it, what's going on. And just really opening up to being human. I think for parents, it's difficult to open up to your children because you don't want them to know your history and your past. You don't want them to use that against you or use it as an excuse for them to go do what they want to do. But at the end of it all, kids need to know that their parents are human. Kids need to know that their house or that wherever they dwell is a safe space for them to grow, because they will grow. They will find a place. And so if it's not with you, then you have to, you know, figure out what that looks like. You know, it's okay if it's somebody in their village, but if it's somebody mm-hmm. that you know you don't want them to be around, right. but that's the only person they feel like they can talk to, mm-hmm. then, you know, so you want to make sure you're talking about, this is a safe space. I understand mom may not always like what you're going to say, mm-hmm. but it's important that you get your voice out. We want to talk about self-regulation. When it comes to emotional and social development, we have to be familiar with where kids are and what they're capable of doing. So yeah. sometimes we say, I know you heard what I said. I know you're just trying to do that to get on my nerves or mm-hmm. something like that. And sometimes kids are just developmentally not in a place to understand that. And we have to show grace when it comes to talking to them about that. And then conflict resolution. Sometimes, especially when they're young, we want to just run to their aid and do mm-hmm. stuff for them. Or mm-hmm. we're just talking on the phone. You see them struggling with something. Yeah, girl. And you just go ahead and do it for them. Mm-hmm. And they're just going to be depending on somebody to fix it. Or they might go in survival mode and feel like they do what they have to do in order to get it done. You want to try and teach healthy conflict resolution skills. If you don't really know exactly where to start, mm-hmm. it may just be looking back in your own life. How would I have wanted this situation to go? Whether it's something that happened between you and your parent, whether it happened between you and a friend, or a big situation that happened in your life, how can I pass that on so that my kids can have healthy conflict resolution?
So what do you feel children need from adults?
I touched on a few of them. So I would, again, say grace. They need practice. They need modeling exercise, you know, modeling it for them. They mm-hmm. need examples and transparency. Okay. They need transparency. I think for my daughter and I, that means a lot for her. I think whenever she understands that we are alike, but she has her own personality, and that I appreciate her personality for what it is. And even when I'm just like, you know, she's like, I'm sorry for I did this. I said, you don't have to apologize. Yes, mommy is frustrated, but you didn't do anything wrong to where you have to apologize. And just owning that, making sure that you are open to apologizing. The more you apologize, the easier it is. The more you hold on to it, the harder it is, right? It sometimes feels weird to apologize to a kid, mm-hmm. but they're our future, and we have to model what it is that we want.
Okay. So is it good for us? Because I know as adults, sometimes when we're communicating with each other, mm-hmm. we may say something and then ask the person to repeat, what is it that you heard mm-hmm. me say? Mm-hmm. Is that good to do with the children as well?
I think it is for accountability reasons. However, it definitely has a lot to do with our intentionality. One thing I know about God is that he's really big on your intentions. So if I said, you're an awesome person, I did like this, that yeah. feels good to you. But if right. somebody that I just talked to before, I said, hey, it's kind of like whenever Judas kissed Jesus on the head, that seemed mm-hmm. like a really sweet gesture. Right. However, Jesus knew what it meant. The intentionality behind it was the issue. So if I'm saying, now repeat back to me what I just said, mm-hmm. that's more like I'm trying to check you. I'm exerting my power on you mm-hmm. versus I understand that I understand that sometimes you have difficulty remembering what I said, so I'm going to have you repeat it to me, okay? And even if they, why do I have to do that? Because I want you to be successful. So again, coming back down to this is what the baseline is. Don't cover it up with your mask. Don't cover it up with your pettiness. Don't cover it up with your passive aggressiveness. Push it all away. They are human. Talk with them because you are raising the next generation.
Okay, great. What if an adult feels like the communication between the child and themselves is damaged beyond repair? How do we handle that?
Well, you just have to look at each day as a new day. And I think it's important not to just think that, but to share that with your child. Just say, hey, you know, it'll take some building. Again, you have to create the CD that you want your kids to hear, right? You have to create the CD that you want them to hear. So just saying, tomorrow's a new day, you know, we'll try again tomorrow. If you feel like it's damaged beyond repair, you have to check yourself. You have to see, am I being passive aggressive towards my, okay, if that's what you're going to wear, I guess, then that's what they're going to mimic and they're going to not want to come to because they know what they're going to get, right? We have to just, we have to come to them, we have to apologize. I know things have been rough. I know that we have not been on a great, you know, on the right foot with things, and I just want you to know I'm human too, and I am gonna do my best. You know, parenting is hard. And I want feedback from you. I want to know what I can do to help you, because I do want to support you, and I do want you to, you know, live a happy life. But because we're two different people, it's going to take some time. So again, just coming back to the, look, this is what it is. Mm-hmm. And as long as we can just try every day, some days I'm going to be on top of it, and you may not. Some days you're going to be on top of it, and I'm not. But as long as we can commit to tomorrow's a new day, then you can start there.
Okay. And I think that communication process is great, because allowing children to see us and to see us from the inside out, and not just seeing us from what we portray to everybody else, and getting to know us and knowing that we are being transparent with them, mm-hmm. and knowing that we love them, and knowing that we make mistakes as well, and apologize. You know, back in the day, parents really did not apologize. This is what I said. This is what you do. No, you did not talk. So this is very, very informative. And I do appreciate you sharing this with me. What are some habits to steer clear of when communicating with your children?
Okay, so we are in the age of... We are in the age of whenever somebody wrongs you, okay. we either say, oh, I don't have time for that negative energy in my life. Oh, this is a toxic person, remove them, get them away. And to an extent, that's important, because if it's somebody who is constantly draining you or constantly taking advantage of you or, you know, physically hurting you, that makes sense to remove yourself from that person, you know, allow time to heal or allow yourself to, you know, come to a state where you can, you can talk and things like that. But if it is, you know, in your just normal conversation, a miscommunication, because that's usually what's happening, we miss out on moments for God to work through us whenever we try and shut people down. Whenever we say, oh, you're a toxic family member, so we don't have the same thoughts. You don't accept me for who I am. You don't believe in what in me, you know. Instead of shutting it down, it's important to say, this is a moment where God can grow me. This is a moment where I can be used, and where mm-hmm. that person can be used. And I mean, just being able to do that, God has shown that communication brings people together. That's why I have communication is power.
Right.
Is that what I said? Like, I don't know. Communication and community both have commune. And so that's mm-hmm. like a group of people sharing the same thoughts and doing the same things. And so if we are a community, we have no communication going on, we're going to continue to drift apart. Mm-hmm. And there's so much miscommunication. So
what are some habits to steer clear of when communicating with children?
Okay. So habits to steer clear from is cutting them off, saying, okay, that's how they are. I'm just going to let them be them, and I'm not going to try and help them or save them. Another thing to steer clear of when communicating with children is functioning in a heightened mindset. This is big even for whenever I was young, you know, mm-hmm. whenever you're getting so upset and you're ready to whoop that kid, mm-hmm. what goes into it? That whooping has nothing to do with the actual situation. It has much more to do with how upset you're feeling and what they did to wrong you. And so what should have been, you know, a pop or whatever after 17 times to tell them to get something done, I told you to go do it. Okay. Instead it's wailing off, didn't I tell you to, you know, so we're kind of familiar with that. Mm-hmm. But just checking yourself and saying, what is the actual situation? Mm-hmm. Why am I upset? I need to calm down. Because one thing that I learned about is my state dictates your state. So if I have a nasty state, I'm mad, I'm frustrated, irritated, I can't expect this kid to calm down if I'm talking to you, or I can't expect this child to open up to me if I'm so fired up, and I definitely can't expect to understand what they're struggling with, because any type of behavior is some type of behavior. Negative type of behavior is some type of communication. So they may not be able to express it the way that you want them to, but there is a reason for the way that they're acting. And so we have to be in a regulated mindset in order to listen and hear what the child has to say. And then I think I said staying away from passive aggressive, mm-hmm. Just kind of manipulating them to get them to do what you want them to do, because they in the end will become manipulators and will miss out on true authentic relationships. I think I had another one, but I can't think of it. So.
Okay. So what we need to do is take a breather.
Mm, definitely.
And maybe count to 10 or...
We can. Whatever you need, because everybody is different, right? I like to use my husband and I as examples because we are just completely on opposite ends of the spectrum. I'm much more calm. He has calm in him, but it doesn't come as fluid to him as it does to me. And so for me, I'm able to be calm for a while. But if you do, you know, for me, if I find myself frustrated, I'll even tell my daughter, I said, I need a minute. Mom needs a minute. And I walk away, and we do what we're doing, and I'll come to her, and I'm like, okay, this is why I was upset, right? and then, you know, just even in the classroom, whenever I'm working in the classroom, we can't whoop these kids, right? Not that I'm trying to whoop people's kids out there, but I say that to say this. There's another way to... correct behavior. There's another way to get through things, and a lot of that has to do with communication in the classroom, communication, verbal and nonverbal. So sometimes you have to find what works for you. So if it's count to 10, if it's I need a minute, if it's going to your car and blast Tupac, I mean, you do what you have to do, but just know that it's on the job training for these kids. We know that they didn't ask to be here. So now that they're here, what are you doing to foster it? God has given this child to you renting. You're renting this child. This child is, you know, once they're done, they're gone. Mm-hmm. Whenever they leave, are you pleased with how you parented them? Okay. One thing I tell myself is if my children ever decide they need to go to therapy, I don't want to be the main conversation. So what can I do to make sure I'm not the main conversation? So
okay, so the counselor is not going, well, what was she doing now?
Right.
Okay. So do you have anything else at this time that you would like to share with us?
Yes, I do want to share some scriptures. I'm going to take them out because I don't have them memorized. All right. So the first one is Matthew 7:3-5. Why do you look at the speck of sand in your eye or sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? How can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, when all the time there is a plank in your own eye? You hypocrite, first take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. So behind this one, again, we as parents, we see these kids and we see what they're doing wrong, and we just want to continue to tell them, whether in a very put-down way, a clever way, a petty way, a passive-aggressive way, that they're doing something wrong. But whenever it comes to us, and maybe they try to tell us that, oh, we got an issue with it, right? If that's their CD that they keep replaying, is that, oh, look at that. There you go again. You did it again. You did it again. That's what they're going to do. Mom, you left that door open again. Excuse you, right? We got an issue with it now. So when it comes to regulating yourself, remember, you're not perfect. Your child's not going to be perfect. So just like the grace you wanted, put that on your CD. Make that, you know, a part of their thing. I'm giving you grace. Hey, I noticed that this happened again. It's totally fine. You're not in trouble, but I just wanted to see if you need any help. How can we help you remember to do that moving forward? It could be charts for your younger ones. It could be charts. It could be a text for your older ones. Mm-hmm. Whatever it is, but you want to try and incorporate them in their learning, right? Giving them models, giving them examples, giving them space to practice and to learn and to grow. The next one... Matthew 18:3, truly I say to you, unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. So I brought this one up because sometimes we as adults forget how important children are. And we can say it all day, but I mean, you can just look at our, you know, the education system, like how in the U.S. we have like some of the lowest performing, you know, grades or schools, what have you. We're down there. And so we have to remember that God finds kids precious, so precious that he wants us to come to him in such a way. And to me, that when I think of a child and how precious they are, I think of their trust, mm-hmm. their vulnerability, and their love. For us, because we've been so jaded as adults, we start to have these coping mechanisms. We start to put on these masks. We start to have our planned, what's it called? In our generation, clapbacks. We have these planned clapbacks of what we're going to say mm-hmm. instead of, again, pushing away that nitty-gritty and just saying, okay, I don't understand, but I'm going to trust you through this. Or, yes, I'll forgive you. For sure, I'll forgive you. Like kids do, right? Yes, mm-hmm. I'll forgive you. Yes, we can try this again. Mm-hmm. I don't mind, mm-hmm. right? Even if it's just a quiet, you know, just showing that I'm sorry, you know? And so I just wanted to bring that up. Ephesians 6:4, fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord.
Okay.
So this one, we often talk about the children, honor your mother and father, blah, mm-hmm. blah, 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 blah. And we use that clever, I'm smarter than you, I'm taking over the power to show mm-hmm. you, put you in your place. You're supposed to respect me. But God says, whoa, don't get power hungry. You don't provoke these kids, because again, that's that CD that we keep playing for them. So if we're going to keep, oh, you're doing this, you're doing this, you're doing this, we're just setting them up for failure. And at that age, mm-hmm. it's not that they don't feel what we feel whenever somebody provokes us. Mm-hmm. They just don't have the words to express how they're feeling and what they're thinking. And so they know that wrong is being done to them, mm-hmm. but they don't know how to express it. And unfortunately, you start seeing things like kids fighting, kids, you know, doing sneaky things, kids harming themselves, things like that, because they're trying to figure out how to deal with the wrong that's being done to them, and they're not having an opportunity to talk about it, to have that communication with somebody. And then I have Proverbs 3:24, whoever spares the rod hates their children, but the one who loves their children is careful to discipline them. So again, this is one of those verses that we think about. I can whoop my child, right? Mm-hmm. Some people are like, don't whoop the child. It's more like, so I'm using this scripture to support the part that, yes, it's important to have discipline for your child, right? But it doesn't mean that you have to spank or hit your child all the time, right? I kind of break it up into three sections. You have your kid number 1, 2, and 3. One's the one that, like, if they do something wrong, then just talking to them gets them all scared, right? Then child number 2, you know, they may have little advocacy, right? Well, why can't I do this? Why can't I do that? You know, we may have to send them a time out for a moment so they can calm down, or take a toy, you know, take something away and they can earn it back. Mm-hmm. And then you have kid 3 who's like, I'm going to do what I want to do, right? I know what you said, but what I'm going to do is going to be worth that whooping, waiting at home, or worth me missing this, you know? So you just have to know your child, and you have to discipline accordingly. So the training that I got for about 10 years in school, beautiful, wonderful training called Conscious Discipline. It's talking about the mindsets of the kids. If they're in an angry mindset, they're in fight, flight, or break, or shut down, right? So they're not in the moment to have a conversation. So they need to know, I am safe, I am loved, right? I can do this. Then if we can shift them into the next mindset, which is they're in their emotional state where they can actually start talking about what's happening. It's not in the third state where we want them to be, but it's better than the red state, right? And so, well, why are you feeling that way? You know, they need to be able to get that out. I feel this because, right? Mm-hmm. And that's a great model that you can have for the kids. Hey, I understand, you know, when you get upset, you start throwing stuff, but instead, let's try this. I feel this because. If they're in red brain, they ain't trying to do all that, right? But if we can get them down to there, my state dictates your state. If I'm calm, if I'm regulated, and I'm not, what did you do? You just think. Mm-hmm. And they're doing what they're doing. Okay, sweetie. So you're upset, what's going on, right? Mm-hmm. And then you can get them to their green state, which is the, I'm ready to talk now. I'm ready to problem solve. And so if we can work harder on getting them to that green state, that mm-hmm. problem solving state, we can still have discipline for them, because discipline doesn't always have to be a negative thing. It's like boundaries. Kids need boundaries. They want boundaries. Mm-hmm. And we have to be able to give that to them, but we got to give them healthy boundaries, right? It can't be, I'm going to force you, and I'm going to hit you, slap you, and I'm going to threaten to take away stuff all the time. That's how I keep my child in line. See, they're quiet. See, they do everything that you want them to do. Mm-hmm. But when they're out of your hands, somebody on a show said, my parents love me because they don't know me. And that's something that I want to make sure my kids never have to say, right? So those are the scriptures that I want to talk about. I do have a website, ladyjcreates.com, lady, the letter J, creates.com. On that website, I have a calendar, two calendars. The first calendar for June has all scriptures related to communication, okay. One scripture a day. And then another June calendar that has QR codes. Each QR code is linked to some type of resource. So conscious discipline resources. If you're a person who likes, you know, to be on social media, I have some for Instagram, Facebook, YouTube. And then I have just some websites that have some great resources, some in Spartanburg. So I hope you get a chance to check it out, and I hope they're helpful.
Okay, well, thank you so much, Sister Crudup.
Thank you.
This has been so informative. I have learned so much from you today. And we would like to thank each of you for joining Community Conversations. Until the next time.
We hope that this community conversation has been informative, inspiring, and empowering. If it has, we ask that you please like, share, and comment on this video. We also invite you to like and follow our Facebook and YouTube channels for more soul-feeding content. We'll see you next time for our community conversations.